Better turn that off. Welcome to Green Lake Church. And we're gonna start with our prelude, and our prelude is by Wanda Griffith. Here we go.
Good morning and welcome to Green Lake Church. Welcome to worship at Green Lake Church. We're so glad that you can join us. We hope that our time together this morning blesses you and enriches your life. We have a number of announcements to share with you this morning.
We begin, as usual these days, with our birthdays. So let's see. The first birthday I want to mention is Shirley Mayer. Shirley, happy birthday. I hope that the coming year is a smoother, less eventful one than 2020 has been. So all the best to you, Shirley, and happy birthday. And then let's see, Gumi, you have a birthday greeting to extend.
Yes, I wanted to wish my neighbor happy birthday. And she lives just above the street from me, and that is Monica Cruz. Happy birthday to Monica. Back to you, John. Or is it Wanda?
I think it's me. So I get to wish a couple of birthdays, both to fellow musicians, and the first is to Gabe Mays. So I'm really happy to wish you a happy birthday this week, Gabe, and so enjoy watching your development as a musician and as a young man, and we're all very proud of you and wish you the very best in the coming year. Also, I get to wish a happy birthday to Joyce Grauman. And for those of you who might be a little more new to Green Lake, I wanted to lift up her role in founding the Candlelight Christmas tradition that we're now in our 56th year, which is why we said we just can't let it go. We're going to have it a virtual concert. And so that is still on the calendar for December 18th, Friday night at 7:30. But from some previous programs, there's some history that we've been including. And if I can just read you a few sentences about that. The Green Lake Church Candlelight Christmas Concert began as a way to raise money for a missionary family. In the fall of 1965, the mission project of the local chapter of the Women's Auxiliary of the Loma Linda University School of Medicine, in other words, at that time, wives of Loma Linda University MDs, planned to assist a medical missionary family. Joyce Grauman, the auxiliary president, not knowing she was about to start a tradition, had an idea for a fundraiser. She asked her father-in-law, Dr. Arthur Grauman, the Green Lake Church organist and choir director, could the auxiliary sponsor a Christmas concert featuring Green Lake Church musicians and take a mission offering? Dr. Grauman, a Loma Linda University School of Medicine alumnus, thought it was a splendid idea. So on December 24th, 1965, the first of these concerts took place. And so we still want to say thank you, Joyce, for starting this amazing tradition, even though you thought you were just raising a little money for some people at that time. We have raised, I've never added it up, but it would be interesting to add up all of the funds that have been raised over those 56 years. In fact, maybe I'll follow up before our next one to see where we are. So back to you, John.
Thanks, Wanda. Let's see. Oh, Emily Krilinski, I believe you're on with us. Could you tell us a little bit more about the caroling? I think last night was your first time, but Emily, it's over to you.
Thanks, John. We were actually going to head out last night for the first night, but we had a last minute schedule change. So we are going to be heading out for the first time this Sunday night. And we've had a few of you reach out to us and ask to be included, and we're planning on stopping by. But if anyone else would like to make sure that the holiday cheer caroling reaches you, you're welcome to reach out to us, and I'll be happy to put you into the schedule. So you can email me at emilykrilinski@gmail.com. The email address is in the bulletin, or you can call me if you've got my number. I think it might be in the bulletin too. Anyway, we look forward to seeing some of you this week and having a chance to share a little bit of this holiday spirit, since there's so much that we're missing.
Thanks, Emily. That sounds like a lot of fun. Let's see. Continuing in the holiday spirit. For the last several years, we have raised money at Christmas time for gift cards for some families at Greenwood Elementary School. These are families who probably will not have enough to eat over the holidays without the supplemental nutrition that's available through school. And so we provided these Fred Meyer gift cards so that these families would have a little extra help as they try to get through the holidays. It always touches me to think that here, I mean, just a few miles from our church, a few miles from the Green Lake community, which is such a privileged and blessed community, there are families who don't have enough to eat. And that just blows my mind. But we can help a bit. And so Terry Smith Weller is collecting money to buy these gift cards. So because of the change of the tax thing, for many of us, we don't need a tax receipt for our donations of these kinds of amounts. And if that's you, you can contact Terry directly, give the money to her directly via Zelle or some other way. But you can also give it to the church and designate it for Greenwood Elementary. What Terry would like is, if you are going to give, if you would let her know, and especially if you give through the church, let her know what you have given, because she needs to buy the cards and deliver them by, she needs to have the money by December 10. And if you're pledging to give or given to the church, she needs to know by December 13. That's a Sunday. But this is a great opportunity. Every year, the church has been very, very generous. It brings a lot of joy to my heart to know that we're able to help those families. And our contact at the school has let us know what a big difference it makes. So be in touch with Terry for the Fred Meyer gift cards for hungry families at Greenwood Elementary School. Thanks. A sad note. Roger Ferris died this past Monday evening. Many of you know Roger. Roger was a force to be reckoned with. You know, at one point when he was the pastor of the Volunteer Park Church, I believe it was the largest church in the Washington Conference. One of the major things that Roger did was he put together, he was the driving force behind the creation of Cypress Adventist School. And I've asked Lowell Dunstan, if he would share with us some of his memory of Roger's role in that. And so, Lowell, let's hear from you now.
This past Monday, Roger Ferris, former pastor of Volunteer Park Church and leader in Christian education for many years in the Puget Sound area, passed away. Cypress School didn't just happen. It took people of faith to put it together. And Roger is really the founder of Cypress Adventist School. When he found out the property was available, he pulled together a group of 11 churches in a constituency to operate a Christian education for the people of the Puget Sound area. Roger and Ida gave much over the years to Christian education in our area, both to the Cypress campus, to Auburn Adventist Academy. And so we mourn his passing, a great giant in faith who made significant contributions for Christian education in our area. So Roger, you will be greatly missed.
Thanks, Lowell. I appreciate that. I know at our school board meeting this last week, you shared some of that information and I did not know all of it. So I really appreciated you sharing that. You know, Ida is at their residence in Shoreline at the assisted living facility. And because of COVID right now, she can't have personal visitors, but cards and phone calls would be wonderful. Let's let Ida know that we still care about her and that we still remember her. That would be good. And then I hope that some of you have looked at the bulletin and seen the money news. In the last month, the budget that we were expecting to get was about $5,000 or $6,000, and there was $11,000 that was given for the church budget. So really want to thank you for that. We were running just a little bit behind, and this made a big dent in that. So thank you so much. Also, I want to mention the Jensen House campaign. We've had this wonderful challenge grant. A couple of families have put up $75,000 to match giving from other church members up to that amount. So far, it looks to me like, let's see, there is less than $43,000 left to raise to meet that that challenge grant. If I did my arithmetic right, and that's always sketchy, if I did my arithmetic right based on giving that I know about, we have $42,866 left to raise. So thank you so much for your generosity. The Jensen House has been the anchor of our housing ministry, enabling us to serve families from all over the Pacific Northwest, even from farther away. People who've come to Seattle for medical care, the specialized medical care that's here, and we're able to provide housing for them free of charge. So thank you so much for your help in lowering and eventually eliminating the mortgage on the Jensen House property. That'll be wonderful. All right, Wanda, I think it's time for you to introduce the music in today's service.
Thank you, John. I'm delighted to tell you a little bit about our music today. The offertory was recorded last December in our sanctuary, and it's our our adorable cherub choir. Now, during this time when we can't be in the space, we miss seeing our children, our bright young faces, both in the children's story and in the cherub choir performances. So I was delighted to find this and have it pulled for today. They are singing a traditional carol that is in Latin, and it's so old we don't know who wrote it. It's attributed as anonymous in the sources, and the text they're singing is Gaudete, Gaudete, Christus est natus ex Maria. So basically, rejoice, rejoice, Christ is born of Mary. And so they have lots of enthusiasm. Latin's a little hard to understand sometimes, but don't worry about it. The enthusiasm is the point. And they're accompanied by a delightful array of medieval sounding instrumentalists, Lisi Case on harp and Rick Roberts on recorder, Scott Callender on percussion, and Michelle Carlil on cello. So that should be a delight for you. I certainly enjoyed previewing it. And then we will have one of our handbell pieces that Gumi has recorded this fall with some of our ringers, In the Bleak Midwinter, which is a beautiful traditional melody and talks about, you know, how, of course, in this part of the world, we think of it as cold in winter as opposed to New Zealand where it's not. But it's a beautiful tune and beautifully arranged and beautifully filmed. So that is our special music this morning. And I think John's got some more information about the music today.
Usually we begin our service with a morning hymn and an invocation. And the word invocation, it means to invite God in among us or to accept his invitation to be with him. For the month of Advent here, we will not have a spoken invocation. Instead, we will have a sung invocation. The hymn that I'm sure many of us know, the Christmas hymn, O Come, Emmanuel. And we will have various versions of that, very performances of that as the invocation throughout this Advent season. And so now, let's begin our Advent season with O Come, Emmanuel.
O come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel, that once in lonely exile here, until the Son of God appear. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, thou strength from on high, and cheer us by thy drawing nigh. Disperse the
Shalom, peace. Grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come. How beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of him who brings good tidings, who publishes peace, who brings glad tidings of good, who publishes salvation, who says to Zion, your God reigns. Shalom. Let us hear the Lord speak, for he will speak peace to his people, to his faithful, to those who turn to him in their hearts. Shalom. The wolf shall dwell with the lamb, and the leopard shall lie down with the young goat, and the calf and the lion and the yearling together. and the little child shall lead them. Shalom. In a world of strife, the Lord says, "My children, do as I teach you and live at peace. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God." Shalom. For unto us a child is born, unto us a child is given. And the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Peace. Shalom.
Offering today is for the church budget, as it is twice a month. And I want to focus particularly on those things in the budget that are outreach and that are things that hold the congregation together. The outreach things that we support are the Ronald McDonald House, the housing ministry, Hands Across the Water, and Feeding the Homeless. Those are very important things and are supported by the church budget. The other thing that has grown very much since the pandemic is the technology that helps hold us together even though we can't be in the same place. And that is the technology of Zoom, the technology of YouTube. We're very grateful for the Sabbath school classes on Zoom, the Sabbath school classes of the groups that call in, and we're very grateful for the worship services and those who prepare them on Zoom and on YouTube. They keep us, as John often says, together even though we must be apart. Will you bow your heads with me as we give thanks and bless the offering? Lord our God, thank you so much that you have blessed us so that we can give. Thank you so much for the postal system which will deliver checks. Thank you for the banking system that will transfer money. Please bless it. Please help it to go where it should do to further your work in the world. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Good morning, boys and girls. This morning, we're sharing the story of Christmas Island. Joseph and Mary Carpenter should have been excited. It was Christmas Eve, but Joseph was mad and really sad. 3 months before that, he'd gotten the bad news that he had muscular dystrophy, and so he was losing this ability to control his arms and legs. He was a very good auto mechanic in the city of Portland, Maine, but he could no longer work on cars and do repairs. So they put their shop up for sale, sold it, and they wanted to find someplace cheap to live in a small community. So they were able for $460, which is about a month's salary, to buy an old lighthouse up on off from Gull Island in Portland, Maine. As Christmas drew near, Joseph felt worse and worse because the island people didn't like outsiders. And so when Mary went shopping to the grocery store, they charged her higher prices than the local people. And when Joseph went to buy kerosene, which they had to have for cooking and heating and for lights, they charged him more, and he could hardly lift the cans into the little boat to get across the water out to the lighthouse off from Gull Island. And every day that went by, Joseph hated the place more and more. But Mary says, "I will move later, but I just feel we have to stay here in the lighthouse until our son is born." Because Mary had found an old cradle made out of driftwood, she says, "I want to be able to rock our newborn child in this wonderful little cradle." Christmas Eve came, and the baby arrived just before midnight. All of a sudden, when Joseph held the new baby, all of his feelings of anger and hate disappeared, and he wanted to tell the world that their first child had arrived. So he took some of the precious kerosene and lit the 5 old lamps in the lighthouse, and right on the stroke of midnight, light blazed out from those 5 lamps and lighted up the whole dark sky. What he didn't know was until the next morning at 6 o'clock, when the radio stations came on, at the very moment he lit the lights in the lighthouse, there was an airplane that had lost its way, the control center had quit, and was ready to crash land in the village of Gull Island. And all of a sudden, in the darkness of the sky, the pilot saw these blazing lights lighting up the landscape, and he was able to be directed to Portland, Maine, and land safely. The people at Gull Island were stunned the next morning to realize that they could have been killed in their snug little houses if the plane had crashed in the middle of their island community. And so, a few days later, Joseph and Mary Carpenter were no longer outsiders, but they were welcomed as people of Gull Island. And the islanders, instead of calling them outsiders and shunning them, the islanders built them a new house in the center of the village, and a large room in front so they could sell gifts and make some money and have it a trading center. And it's no longer called Gull Island, it's now called Christmas Island. And that's the story of the transformation of Joseph and Mary Carpenter because of the birth of a new child and the saving of a whole village that might have been destroyed if a plane crash landed in their midst. So that is a new Joseph and Mary Christmas story. And that's how Christmas Island got its name.
Will you join me in prayer and bow your heads? O God, our Creator, and God, our Sustainer, we come to you with our heavy burdens today. We're so heavy with weariness, with adjusting and readjusting, with not being able to meet, and unable to see each other face to face, with trying to be cheerful on difficult days, and with bearing up in sickness and in distress. We pray especially for the people in our congregation who have asked for prayers. Prayers for Becky Meacham's sister, for Davy Reed, Diane Carlisle, Ed and Alma Gonzaga, the Green Lake child care and preschool teachers, and Nola Jean Bamberry. May we do more than merely pray, Lord, for their well-being and their health. May we do and may we be for them, please. Many of us in this holiday season grieve that we can't be with our friends and our family who are far away. And even more deeply, we carry the burden of grief for those dear ones in our family and in the church community who have passed away. We in the family of J.R. Josiah and Roger Ferris mourn their passing. We pray for your comfort. Thank you for the assurance that we will meet our loved ones again in heaven, and that every tear will be wiped away. We thank you for the goodness that even in our distress surrounds us. Thank you for the pleasant weather this past week. Thank you for the telephone which helped connect us, even as the technology that enables us to see each other on FaceTime or Skype or on Zoom. We thank you for both of those. They make possible contacts from friends and from loved ones. Thank you for nurturing with us, within us, the knowledge that you love us even more than our friends and our family do. Thank you that we may receive these blessings of love and nurture, and thank you that we can pass them on as your hands and feet and heart in the world to others. We ask that you will be with Pastor John, both today as he preaches and in his life. We give thanks for his ministry with us and to us these past 8 years. We pray for his and his family's well-being and enjoyment as he begins his well-deserved retirement in a few weeks. We pray for elected officials worldwide. May they do justice with mercy. And may we encourage and assist and insist that they do so. Thank you, lastly, that we as your children can pray together with your Son, Jesus. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
The Old Testament reading is from Isaiah 40, 9 through 11. O Zion, messenger of good news, shout from the mountaintops. Shout it louder, O Jerusalem. Shout and do not be afraid. Tell the towns of Judah, your God is coming. Yes, the sovereign Lord is coming in power. He will rule with a powerful arm. See, he brings his reward with him as he comes. He will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will carry the lambs in his arms, holding them close to his heart. He will gently lead the mother sheep with their young.
Thank you.
The New Testament reading is from Luke 1, 67 to 75. Then his father, Zechariah, was filled with the Holy Spirit and gave this prophecy. Praise the Lord, the God of Israel, because he has visited and redeemed his people. He has sent us a mighty Savior from the royal line of his servant David, just as he promised through his holy prophets long ago. Now we will be saved from our enemies and from all who hate us. He has been merciful to our ancestors by remembering his sacred covenant, the covenant he swore with an oath to our ancestor Abraham. We have been rescued from our enemies so we can serve God without fear, in holiness and righteousness for as long as we live. May the Lord bless the hearing of the word.
Thank you to all of you who help make this service happen. I really like that bells piece. That was wonderful. Thank you for putting that together, Shelley, and all the folks there who helped you with that. Also, the cherub choir. Oh, that was wonderful. And thank you, Wanda, for telling us what they were saying, because we could see the enthusiasm, and it was nice to have your translation of the words for us. So thank you. And to all the rest of you who helped make this service happen. Thank you so much. I understand this morning there were 10 kids in the first primary Sabbath school class. Up until now, we've had the children from infants up through primary in one class. Today, we broke it out, and so there were two classes, one for the younger kids, one for the primary age. And there were 10 kids in the primary class this morning. So thank you to all who helped make that happen. Wow, that's a lot of work. Thank you. I begin this morning with a paraphrase, if you will, mixing translations from our Old Testament reading. O thou that tellest good tidings to Zion, get thee up unto a high mountain. Lift up your voice. Say unto the cities of Judah, behold your God. Good tidings, good news. Lift up your voice, shout it. Make sure everybody hears the news. What is the news? Behold your God. God is at hand. You know, it's a classic messianic passage. The prophet looking out there into the future and sees a day when finally we are not waiting and wondering when, but we're announcing, behold, now God is here. The messianic age has started. Finally, everything's going to be made right. Then a few verses later, we read the prophet's characterization of what it is like when the Messiah arrives. When God shows up, what happens? Excuse me. He will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms and carry them in his bosom and gently lead those who are with young. This passage, the beginning, you know, shout, good news, God is here. The messianic age has begun. And then this picture, he will gently lead those with young. He will carry the stragglers in his bosom. This captures the essence of the messianic hope of the Bible. A mighty, powerful ruler will come. And what will this mighty, powerful ruler do? He will take care of those who are lowly and powerless. Notice this picture. Carrying the weak ones, gently leading those who are with young, accommodating weakness, accommodating human need, making things better for the ones who are least able to help themselves. A fascinating example of this messianic hope, this picture of the age of Messiah being the age when those who can't help themselves finally receive help, is Hannah's song in the book of 2 Samuel, the second chapter, the book of 1 Samuel, the second chapter. Now, Hannah's story, you need to know the backstory for these words. Hannah had been married to a man named Elkanah. She was married to a man named Elkanah. Hannah couldn't have kids, so Elkanah had taken a second wife so that he could have kids. And in that culture, of course, that was not all that remarkable. The second wife did have kids. And then she mercilessly taunted and ridiculed Hannah because Hannah was in second place because she did not have kids. And Elkanah tried to reassure Hannah, oh, don't I mean more than you to you than a dozen kids? But it didn't work. Hannah knew that she was second class. In her own home, she was second class behind the other woman. In society, she was held in at least mild contempt because she was a woman without children, a woman who could not have kids. She felt the weight of this, the scorn and contempt. And every year the family would go up to the temple to pray and for an annual feast. One year she's there and she goes to the temple and she's praying an agonizing prayer, begging God for a child. And the high priest notices her praying and sees her agony, the emotion, and he scolds her. He thinks she's drunk. And she goes, No, I'm not drunk. She says, I'm just pouring out my heart to God because I want a son so bad. And the high priest says to her, go home, woman, the Lord bless you, and you will have a child this year. And sure enough, she did. And at some point then we have this song of Hannah. And as you listen to it, first you feel some of the emotion that is tied up in her personal rivalry with the other woman in the home. But you also quickly hear, no, this is more than just Hannah's song about her personal situation. This is a song about all of those who are lowly and unable to help themselves. Listen to these words. Stop acting so proud and haughty. Don't speak with such arrogance, for the Lord is a God who knows what you have done, and he will judge your actions. The bow of the mighty is now broken, and those who stumbled are now strong. Those who were well fed are now starving, and those who were starving are now full. The childless woman now has seven children, and the woman with many children wastes away. The Lord gives both death and life. He brings some down to the grave, but raises others up. The Lord makes some poor and others rich. He brings some down and lifts others up. He lifts the poor from the dust and the needy from the garbage dump and sets them among princes, placing them in seats of honor. For all the earth is the Lord's, and he has set the world in order. Did you notice this language? A grand reversal. You know, those who were well fed are now starving. Those who were starving are now full. The childless woman now has seven children. The woman with many children is now wasting away. He lifts the poor from the dust and raises them from the garbage dump and gives them seats among the princes. It's this grand reversal. The lowly are elevated. The high and mighty are brought low. This is a theme in messianic prophecies. You know, in the centuries since Jesus, since the life and death of Jesus, Christian theologians have all through the Old Testament, they see literary arrows pointing toward the work of Messiah, toward the work of Jesus. You know, practically in every place where there's a portrayal of the triumph of goodness, the triumph of righteousness, the elevation of the lowly. The theologian said, ah, another arrow pointing to the Messiah. Listen to these words from Psalm 37. And these words probably apply with special force in today's world. You know, let's let these words talk to us now. Be still in the presence of the Lord. And I think about this in my morning time when I sit quiet, because like most people, I can get pretty wound up and anxious and tied in knots. But every morning I take some time to be still in the presence of the Lord. The psalmist says, be still in the presence of the Lord and wait patiently for him to act. Patience is not one of my virtues. Maybe you have more patience than I, but the psalmist says, wait, wait patiently. Oh, that's hard. Then he says, do not worry about evil people who prosper. Do not fret about their wicked schemes. Stop being angry. Turn from your rage. Don't lose your temper. It leads only to harm. For the wicked will be destroyed, but those who trust in the Lord will possess the land. In another place, it says, the meek will inherit the land. That's a few verses later. Soon the wicked will disappear. Though you look for them, they will be gone. The lowly will possess the land and will live in peace and prosperity. Again, notice the grand reversal, the elevation of the powerless, the raising up of the lowly. And then remember those words, do not lose your temper. It only leads to harm. For the wicked will be destroyed, but those who trust in the Lord will possess the land. Do not fret. Do not be anxious. It's really fun to tell other people that, isn't it? Don't worry, don't worry. Quit fretting. But it's kind of hard to practice ourselves. Do not fret. Do not be anxious, because the Messiah is coming. Messiah will set everything right. Now, some people hear these words and they protest. Ah, but what do you mean? You know, if we don't fret and we hope for the Messiah, does that mean we sit around and do nothing? No. But what it means is we act with courage, because we know that we are acting in concert with the Messiah. When we do what we can to make the world better, we are working with God, and we're working with the winning concept, if you will. So do not fret. Do not be anxious. Yes, let's do what we can to make things better in the places where we are. Let's use our influence for good. But let's do it with that, with a quietness that comes from having these words in our minds. The wicked will be destroyed. Though you look for them, they will be gone. So let's make sure that we devote ourselves to righteousness and cooperate with the Messiah now, so that we are prepared for the full glory of the Messianic kingdom to come. Here's another passage. This one is from the prophet Ezekiel. And Ezekiel is talking about King Zedekiah, the king in Jerusalem. And also, well, the commentators tell us this passage really kind of talks about Zedekiah and his sons and nephews who came after him, serving for just a brief time on the throne. But listen to this passage. Oh, you corrupt and wicked prince of Israel, your final day of reckoning is here. This is what the sovereign Lord says. Take off your jeweled crown, for the old order changes. Now the lowly will be exalted and the mighty will be brought down. Again, that grand reversal. Then the prophet goes on speaking for God and says, I will destroy the kingdom. And eventually I will give it to the one who has a right to judge it. Again, a clear messianic reference. There's going to be a righteous ruler who is worthy to rule. And what will make him worthy to rule? What's the sign of this worthiness? Now the lowly will be exalted and the mighty will be brought down. The carrying of the lambs in the arms. the walking gently with those who are with young. Now, one of the things that I think it's important for us to keep in mind as we read this messianic prophecy in the Old Testament, the Jewish people were an insignificant people on the world stage at that time. Jerusalem was a minor town. It was not a great metropolis. And it's easy for us sometimes to read about messages where God says, look, I'm going to rescue Jerusalem. I'm going to rescue the lowly. And we go, oh, good, God's going to rescue me. God's going to rescue us. And that's okay, but we need to be careful. Because as Americans, we are not Jerusalem. We are Babylon. We are the great empire. We are not Jerusalem in Jesus' day. We are Rome. Again, the great empire. We are citizens of the dominant empire across human history. So when we read this messianic language, let's not imagine that we are the lowly that are going to be lifted. Now, some of us may fit that. But let's recognize that corporately, as a nation, we are the mighty that will be brought low. So let's prepare ourselves for that. Because a lowly place is not necessarily a bad place. And one of the things that strikes me with this, there's going to be a grand reversal. If suddenly I'm going to be taken out of my privileged place and assigned the place that a whole bunch of other people have, maybe the way to get ready for that day is to make sure that their place is a good one so that when I have to live in it, it's a good place to live in. You know, if we work together to make life better for all people, then there is no threat implied when it says that I'm going to live the same life that all those others are living, because we're all working together and we all are sharing in the blessings that God has sent our way. One more prophetic passage to share with you. This one is from Zephaniah, an obscure prophet there in the Old Testament. Listen to this. Excuse me. My scattered people who live beyond the rivers of Ethiopia will come to present their offerings. On that day, you will no longer need to be ashamed, for you will no longer be rebels against me. I will remove all proud and arrogant people from among you. There will be no more haughtiness on my holy mountain. Those who are left will be lowly and humble, for it is they who trust in the name of the Lord. The remnant of Israel will do no wrong. They will never tell lies or deceive one another. They will eat and sleep in safety, and no one will make them afraid. Sing, O daughter of Zion, shout aloud, O Israel. Be glad and rejoice with all your heart, O daughter of Jerusalem. Again, the passage in Psalm that I read, which began with, be still before the Lord. I want to encourage us to fill our minds and hearts with these grand words, these glorious words. As we go through the Christmas season, let the Christmas story sink in. The story of God who came and lived among us. The story of the kings who came because they recognized in the baby the very presence of God. The story of the refugees, Mary, Joseph, and Jesus running to Egypt. Let's open our hearts and understand that God lives in the lowly ones. God lives among the disadvantaged ones. And let's look for ways that we can be part of God's help for those who need help. I finish with our New Testament reading. It's a prophecy, it's a song, if you will, by Zechariah, the father of John the Baptist, who was the precursor of Jesus there in the New Testament. And notice the echo here in Zechariah, in his words, the echo of the prophets of old. Here's what Zechariah said after the birth of his son, John the Baptist. Praise the Lord, the God of Israel, because he has visited and redeemed his people. He has sent us a mighty Savior from the royal line of his servant David, just as he promised through his holy prophets long ago. Now we will be saved from our enemies and from all who hate us. He has been merciful to our ancestors by remembering his sacred covenant. Excuse me. I will see if I can get through this. Got a tickle in my throat. We will be saved from our enemies and from all who hate us. He has been merciful to our ancestors by remembering the covenant that he made. We have been rescued from our enemies, and now I like this line, so that we can serve God without fear in holiness and righteousness all our days. The point of the work of the Messiah is to liberate us to live without fear in righteousness and holiness all our days, to join with God in caring for the needy, to join with God in raising the lowly, to join with God in loving his world. Merry Christmas. I hope that this Advent season fills you with joy as together we remember and celebrate the birth of Jesus and pledge ourselves to carrying forward in our world his great mission. And now we'll have our closing hymn.
Alert from calendar. Video and audio recording.
Thank you.
Let's pray together. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Thanks for joining us here at Green Lake Church for worship today. Really glad you could be with us. Hope you can join us again next week. Remember, we have Sabbath school classes, some beginning at 9:30, some at 10. Classes for every age group, a variety of interests, different Bible books that they are focused on studying. And it's a wonderful way to connect with people and to have a spiritual conversation. So hope you can join us for Sabbath school and then for church next week. And remember, December 18, 7:30, Friday night, our 56th annual Candlelight Christmas concert right here on YouTube. Hope you can join us. Now, may the Lord keep you through the week. And Wanda Griffiths, our minister of music, will take us out with our postlude.